So welcome to module 5 of point set topology course. Last time we introduced the notion of epsilon delta continuity on metric spaces, showed that it is equivalent to sequential continuity. That was a major result last time. So today we will use that and see a number of examples basically. So here I have stated a theorem which is again using sequential continuity, okay. So first of all, we must see what happens to the sequences of functions, sequences inside k power n, okay. So that is the first theorem here. Consider k power n with the Euclidean metric, which I have denoted by D2UE, and I am just recalling it here. Instead of X and Y, I am writing U and V, it doesn't matter. That is what you must be able to do. I range from 1 to n, modulus of UI minus VI square, then take the square root. Suppose UN, now I can't write this UN lower because U itself is a vector U and U to UN. So I am putting a superscript here. This is sequence in K power M. Okay. So I have changed this N here. That's why I have put M here. Now it's in K power M. So this formula is true for all N after all, right? So I can't fix that one. This N I am better, I use for sequences. So sequence in K power M where each un is un1, unm, and so on. So there are m of them, m tuples of numbers here, real number, complex numbers, whatever. So that's the n tuple of, it's a vector. So it's a sequence of vectors, okay? So this is a notation. Suppose this sequence converges to u under this metric, okay? And that u I can write as u and u to um, okay, plane vector. Then and then only, so this depends on if each coordinate function here ui n converges to ui, I less than or equal to m1 for all m, okay, 1, 2, 3 up to m. Okay, so each coordinate function converges to a point, you take corresponding vector, that will be the limit of the entire sequence here. This is what it is. So just like a sequence of complex numbers converges if and only if each real part and imaginary part, you get two sequences, both of them converge. So that has been generalized here for any k power n. Okay. So let us just go through this one. How this is just simple. UN converges to U, okay, then what does it imply? Given epsilon positive, choose a K belonging to N such that P bigger than K implies distance between UP and U is less than epsilon. What is this distance? This is the square root of the sum of the squares, okay. So that immediately implies that each thing here must be less than epsilon, because the square root of this whole thing is less than epsilon, the square will be less than epsilon square. So each must be, because these are all positive numbers, each must be less than epsilon square, so square root should be less than epsilon. So each UIP minus UI must be less than epsilon. Okay, so you are finished. The same P will do the job for all the sequences. Okay, so what does it mean? UN converges to U means each UPN, UIP converges to UI. So that is the meaning. Now, conversely, you have to work a little hard. That's why I have put it here. Conversely, suppose each of them converge. the coordinate functions. Given an epsilon, I should produce a case such that this happens now, right? So what do I do? First of all, what I get is, for each sequence, I get a ki belonging to n such that p is bigger than ki will imply modulus of upi minus ui is less than something. That something I am choosing, not this epsilon, but epsilon by square root of n. Apply it to the convergence for this number. Okay, so this happens. Now you choose k to be the maximum of all these k1, k2. So I have each, for each I have a ki, take the maximum of k1, k. If p is bigger than a maximum, it is bigger than each ki, so all of them will be true. Okay, you take the square, that will be less than epsilon square by m. Take the summation, there are m of them, so it will be less than epsilon square. When you take the square root, you will get this one. Okay, so I haven't written down that. I have asked you to check this one, but I have told you how it works. All right. So as a corollary, what we get is, look at the projection maps, pi I, the coordinate projection, km to k. Okay. So u is ui, ui is ith coordinate projection. They are continuous. How do you get the continuous? If up tends to u, pi I of up is just ui, ui p tends to ui. So that's what we have proved already. So this is a part of corollary here, part of that theorem. You don't have to use if and only, just one part. So coordinate functions are continuous. Okay, now we will improve upon this one. Take a metric space, take a function from x to k power n. Any function in the product is the same thing as giving you m functions, an n tuple of an m tuple of functions, f1, f2, fm, right? So look at one function that is gives you m functions here. What are they? They are just fi, f1, f2, fm, which are just pi I composite f. First apply f and then take the ith coordinate of whatever you get. Okay, that is fi. Each fi, so condition is if and only if each coordinate functions, each of them is continuous. Okay, all of them are continuous. So how do you prove that? Same thing. Start with sequential continuity. You see, that's easier than finding epsilon delta and so on. Take xn tending to x in x now. Put un equal to f of xn. Then you apply that theorem. Okay, uni will be what? Will be fi of xn. All right. So you see, sequential continuity helps you. Once, that is why we converted this epsilon delta thing here into sequential continuity in this one. Okay. So that was the theorem that we had proved last time. So you can apply that. A function is continuous if and only if each coordinate function is continuous. As an additional corollary, let us prove that the addition in Kn as well as the scalar multiplication are continuous. Note that if you take two vectors u and v, u plus v, the ith coordinate of u plus v is nothing but ui plus vi, the ith coordinates being added. Similarly, the scalar multiple alpha of u, where u is a vector, its ith coordinate is alpha times ui. Therefore, from our theorem 2.1.20, the statement of this corollary reduces to the case when n equal to 1 by taking the coordinates. Okay, but once you put n equal to 1, this is nothing but the theorem 1.20, which you have stated last time. Since we have only stated and not proved it, actually, we said that you must have done it in your real analysis course and so on. In any case, for the completeness, Let us prove it now. Okay. Yeah. Consider the function first, the addition, which I denote by alpha, right? K cross K to K given by alpha of x plus x comma y is x plus y. To prove the continuity of alpha at any point, say x naught, y naught, given epsilon, choose delta equal to epsilon by 2. Now, suppose this xy is in the ball b delta x naught y naught. Remember, what is b delta of x naught y naught? It's all points xy is a set, their Euclidean distance from x naught y naught is less than delta. Okay, in particular, if you look at the modulus of x minus x naught, it's always less than the Euclidean distance of xy from x naught y naught, because this is nothing but the square root of the sum of x minus x naught square and y minus y naught square. So it will be smaller than individual ones square and then take the square root. So this is always true, which we have used earlier also. Similarly, y minus y naught is also less than delta, right? Therefore, what you get is alpha of xy minus alpha of x naught y naught will be less than, what is this one? This is nothing, x plus y minus x naught plus y naught, which is x minus x naught plus y minus x naught. The modulus will be less than or equal to modulus of x minus x naught plus y minus y naught. Each of them is less than delta. Therefore, the whole thing is less than twice delta, which is epsilon. Okay. The proof of the multiplication, continuity of multiplication, is slightly more complicated. Okay, so let us go through that. So I want to prove this multiplication, scalar multiplication, K is continuous at x naught, y naught, right? So given epsilon, I want to choose a delta appropriately. First of all, look at x naught, y naught, take the maximum of the two, okay, add one, call that number as one, m. M is maximum of mod x naught, mod y naught plus one. Then choose delta to be the minimum of epsilon by 2m comma 1. Okay, I want it to be less than epsilon by 2m, but I also want it to be less than 1. That's why I'm taking the minimum of the 2. Okay, now suppose xy is in b delta of x naught, y naught as usual, then I want to show that alpha of mu of xy minus mu of x naught y naught is less than epsilon. That's what I have to show. Okay, so as before, we have the moment xy is inside this ball, x minus x naught modulus and y minus y naught modulus, both of them will be less than delta. Moreover, now x minus x naught less than delta implies mod x itself is less than mod x naught plus delta, and this delta is less than 1, right? So this should be less than m. Okay, so this is less than m. So if we put all these things together, what you get is now mu of xy minus mu of x naught y naught, the modulus of that is modulus of xy minus x naught y naught. We rewrite it as x times y minus y naught plus x y naught minus x naught y naught, add and subtracted. So this is modulus of x times y minus y naught plus modulus of x minus x naught times y naught. Okay, and that is less than or equal to m times epsilon by 2m plus epsilon by 2m. Okay, that m times comes out both for both of them here. This is for y naught and this is for x. So both less than. So this completes the proof of theorem 1.20 that we have stated earlier. And along with that, the corollary 1.24 is also proved. Okay, so we have this very important theorem here. I have just stated the corollary, that doesn't matter. Okay, so as an example of application of this one, any polynomial map P from K to K. What is a polynomial map? Polynomial is something like C naught plus C1x plus Cnx power n, where C1, C2, Cns are scalars, right? So I want to say that any polynomial map is also continuous. Constants are continuous. The first thing I use is that apply scalar, the x going to x is continuous identity map. So multiply the two of them, that will be continuous, which means x square is continuous. Multiply again, that will x cube is continuous. That means all monomial functions, x going to x power n, they are continuous. So now you can add two of them at a time. So C naught is continuous, C naught, C1 times x is continuous, so C naught plus C1x is continuous, and so on. Finitely many of them you have to add, that will be also continuous. Okay. We can go one step further, namely any polynomial map in any number of variables, finitely many, x1, x2, xn going to summation C alpha x power alpha mod alpha is less than or equal to D. This is the notation. If D is 0, this is just a constant, there is no choice. If D is 1, you can take x1, you can take x2, you can take x3 and all monomials of degree 1 you can take. If degree 2, then you have x square, x1 square, x2 square, all of them. Not only that, you have xi into yj. Or sorry, xi into xj. So those things will be also there. So how to write all of them? It's a notation here. Take any d, which is a positive integer. Look at all multi-indexes, alpha, which is a1, a2, an, they are all integer, non-negative. Okay, n tuples of integers, because I have n variables here. Okay, sum total of these must be less than or equal to d. That is what you are putting the restriction, because you won't take only finite sum, that's all. Okay, then what is the meaning of this x power alpha? It is one single notation for x1 raised to a1, x2 raised to a2, xn raised to an. So that is the notation. Summation of all a1, a2, an, that is less than or equal to d, I write as mod alpha less than or equal to d. So mod alpha is this one. This is like your taxi cab metric here. Okay. And all these C alphas, they are inside K, they are coefficients. They may be R or C, but more generally, any field will do, but we are concentrating only on real or complex numbers. So such a polynomial is also continuous. Why? Because first of all the xi's are continuous. This is what we have proved. So x1 into x2, x2 into x3, or x5 square, and so on, all of them are continuous. Multiplying them by constants, they are continuous. Then you have to take the sum. So instead of one variable, you have one more, namely here, namely all you have to take various xi's and then take the product. Not just one x and its own powers. Okay. So that's all the differences. So this is again, the argument is similar, but we'll give you all polynomials, whether one variable, two variable, n variable, they are all continuous functions, okay? To be sure, you know that they are also differentiable functions, right? In fact, they are more than that. They are much more than that. They are analytic functions and so on. There is one more notion which you want to recall once again from function of one variable, real variable or complex variable. The definition is exactly the same again. This time again you replace the modulus by the distance function. That's all. Take a function from one metric space to another metric space. It is called uniformly continuous. Then uniform continuity is defined on the entire set A. There's no point in defining it at a single point. Okay. I can define it on some A A container X1 also. That is possible. But now here I'm defining it for all X1. So it will be true for any subspaces also. Okay. So a uniform continuous function is defined for the entire domain here. Okay. Whatever domain you have chosen for the function. So what is the definition? For every epsilon positive, you must have a delta positive such that whenever the points of a domain, you know, they are close by delta, then d1 of y1 x1 is less than delta. Their images must be also satisfy that same relation, but with this epsilon, d2 of fx1, fy1 must be less than epsilon. So you see, there is no reference to given x and epsilon, there exists delta was the definition for ordinary continuity at a point. So there is no reference here. This delta will depend upon epsilon. It will serve the continuity for all points, at all points. In particular, uniformly continuous functions are continuous also in ordinary sense. That is easy. Okay. Indeed, I have not said anything other than replacing the modulus by delta on the d1 and d2. So you must be all familiar with these things. Okay. So for instance, what is the difference between ordinary continuity and uniform continuity? In both the definitions, this delta will depend upon epsilon. Okay. But in the ordinary continuity, it also depends because we start with x for each x and epsilon, there is a delta. So it may depend upon that x also. Okay. In the uniform continuity, there is no starting point at all. You don't have to, it starts with for every epsilon, there exists. Okay. And then the statement is for all points, all pairs of points. Therefore, uniform continuity implies continuity, there is no problem. Okay, but we will see some examples here that in general, uniform continuity, ordinary continuous function may not be uniformly continuous. The first example is the simplest example, namely x going to x square. Okay, you must have checked it. If you haven't, you should check it right now. All right. Doesn't take much time. Not uniformly continuous means what again you have to do? Given epsilon, there existed delta. That is the condition, right? For all t should happen. So what is the negation of that? There is some epsilon. It's that no matter what delta you take, somewhere something goes wrong. That point you can choose freely here. That is the point, because there is no, for every given x, x is not a fixed starting point or anything. Okay, so you can take any number, a one for example, and then show that there is no such delta which will give you the continuity for all the points. So that is what you have to. So having told that much, I will leave it to you. The same thing with t going to e power t is not uniformly continuous. Okay. On the other hand, closely related to them is the trigonometric function sine and cosine. They are uniformly continuous. Okay. I don't want to reveal, there are tricks to see why they are uniformly continuous. I don't want to reveal that to you right now. You think about them. All right. If you have problems with this gun, you should not hesitate to contact us on the platform, namely the discussion form is there. Okay. So there you can ask, I tried this way, but I'm not getting it. Please explain. So our TAs will explain that. So let us look at another example here, namely tangent and cotangent functions. Okay. they are also not uniformly continuous. So this time, the domains are finite domains here, but the codomains are the whole of minus and plus infinity, the entire of R. Okay, so entire of R. These are actually homeomorphisms, one-one mappings here, but they are not uniformly continuous. Okay, so uniform continuity is something somewhat funny thing. It is not a topological, quote unquote, topological property at all. So in topology, you won't much see it at all. In general topology, there is no uniform continuity concept. To bring it, you have to do something like a metric space. Not exactly, something like metric space. What are they called? They are called uniform spaces. Okay, because they can have uniformly continuous functions. So you may have many functions which are continuous but not uniformly continuous. But look at the thing here. It seems to have something to do with the domain and codomain. Okay. So indeed, you have also studied in your really nice course, namely every continuous function on a closed interval is always uniformly continuous. Okay, so though I have given you these examples of not uniformly continuous functions, if you restrict them to any closed interval, they will be uniformly continuous. The emphasis here is it is not uniformly continuous, the whole of R. Similarly, e power t is not continuous on the whole of R. That is the point. If you restrict it to closed intervals, they will be continuous. That is one of the theorem. That theorem, namely, a continuous function on a closed interval is uniformly continuous. That one, we can extend it in some sense, and that is that comes back in topology also, definitely in metric spaces. Later on we'll do that. So here is one example which you might not have seen in your analysis course at all, because this is about metric spaces. Take a metric space, take any non-empty subset. Okay, so the layman's language of distance, I am going to use that. So I am going to take arbitrary points and then talking about the distance of that point to the set. Okay, so that is what d underscore a of x or d of x comma a. Whatever notation you want to use, you can use. So this is defined as infimum of all the distances between A and X, where X is fixed, A varies over A. Look at all these. These are all positive, non-negative real numbers. Okay, take the infimum. Why this is infimum makes sense? Because this is bounded by zero below. So infimum means at worst will be zero, or it may be some positive number. It makes sense. This infimum is called the distance of x from A. Okay, so that is the notation dA of x or d of xA. This function, you can easily check that it is uniformly continuous. You don't have to hunt for a delta, it is there. I will give you that hint. So write down the details yourself. Okay. Any doubts? We'll stop here until next time. Thank you.